Hello guys, this is Indian Medico and in this video we are going to see about abnormal uterine bleeding. This is a concise presentation for medical students. Abnormal uterine bleeding is a common gynecological disorder. Abnormal uterine bleeding is defined as any bleeding from the genital tract that is a deviation from the normal in frequency, cyclicity, duration or quantity. Now let us see about the normal range for each of the above mentioned entities. As of 2018, according to FIGO, the normal frequency of menstruation is every 24 to 38 days. In terms of regularity, the normal variation can be plus or minus 2 to 20 days. The normal duration of menstrual flow is 3 to 8 days. Coming to the quantity should not interfere with the quality of life of the woman. That is, the quantity of menstrual flow should not affect the woman so much so that her quality of life is affected. Usually, the woman soaks around 3 to 6 pads per day normally. Now let us see about the classification of abnormal uterine bleeding according to FIGO. FIGO has classified abnormal uterine bleeding into structural abnormalities and abnormal uterine bleeding unrelated to structural abnormalities. The mnemonic for remembering this is palm coin. Now let us see about structural abnormalities causing abnormal uterine bleeding denoted by the mnemonic palm. P stands for polyp, A stands for adenomyosis, L stands for leiomyoma and M stands for malignancy and hyperplasia. Now coming to the causes of abnormal uterine bleeding unrelated to structural abnormalities denoted by the mnemonic COEIN. C stands for coagulopathy, O stands for ovulatory dysfunction, E stands for endometrial causes, I stands for iatrogenic causes and N stands for not yet classified. Now let us see about each of these causes in detail. Coming to polyps, this picture shows cervical polyps. A polyp is basically an abnormal growth from the mucous membrane. Cervical polyps are common benign growths on the surface of cervical canal. They can cause intermenstrual bleeding and postcoital bleeding. Coming to another type of polyps, that is endometrial polyps. Endometrial polyps are localized outgrowths of endometrium. They can cause heavy menstrual bleeding, intermenstrual bleeding and postmenopausal bleeding. This picture shows endometrial polyps. Now let us see about another structural abnormality that can lead to abnormal uterine bleeding, adenomyosis. Adenomyosis is nothing but presence of endometrial tissue in the myometrium at least one low power field from the basal layer of endometrium. Adenomyosis can lead to heavy menstrual bleeding. This picture shows adenomyosis. As you can see, there is endometrial tissue in the myometrium. Coming to the next cause, leiomyoma. Leiomyoma can be divided into LSM and LO. LSM stands for submucosal leiomyoma and LO stands for other myomas. Leiomyomas are nothing but benign tumors that arise from smooth muscle cells of the uterus and they also contain varying amounts of fibrous tissue. Leiomyomas can cause heavy menstrual bleeding, intermenstrual bleeding, postmenopausal bleeding and irregular bleeding. This picture shows the various types of leiomyoma, namely subserosal, submucosal and intramural. Coming to the next cause of abnormal uterine bleeding, that is malignancy or hyperplasia. This picture shows cervical cancer. Cervical cancer can cause abnormal uterine bleeding in the form of intermenstrual bleeding and postcoital bleeding. Endometrial cancer can cause abnormal uterine bleeding in the form of postmenopausal bleeding, heavy menstrual bleeding and irregular bleeding. Now let us see about the non-structural causes that can lead to abnormal uterine bleeding. The first of which is coagulopathy or bleeding disorders. The various bleeding disorders that can lead to abnormal uterine bleeding are von Willebrand disease, thrombocytopenia, chronic liver disease, leukemias and anticoagulant use. When are anticoagulants used in women? Anticoagulants are indicated in case of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, post-valve replacement, and history of prior venous thrombosis. In these cases, women take anticoagulants and these women are more prone to develop abnormal uterine bleeding. If a woman has coagulopathy, she is more prone to develop heavy menstrual bleeding. Now coming to the next non-structural abnormality, ovulatory dysfunction. It is the most common cause of abnormal uterine bleeding. It is due to an abnormality in the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis. Ovulatory dysfunction is associated with polycystic ovary syndrome, obesity, mental stress, etc. Ovulatory dysfunction can cause irregular bleeding. There can be short cycles with normal or heavy menstrual bleeding. There can be periods of amenorrhea followed by painless, profuse, and prolonged bleeding. This amenorrhea is called anovulatory amenorrhea. There can be periods of amenorrhea followed by scanty bleeding. Now, what is the mechanism of abnormal uterine bleeding in ovulatory dysfunction? Due to ovulatory dysfunction, there will be decreased progesterone. This causes decrease in PGF2-alpha and thromboxane. Basically, these two are vasoconstrictors. Due to the decrease in vasoconstrictors, there will be increased bleeding. Also, there will be increased fibrinolysis, that is increased breakdown of fibrin, which leads to defective coagulation leading to abnormal bleeding. Ovulatory dysfunction may or may not be associated with follicular cysts of ovary and endometrial hypoplasia. Remember, endometrial hypoplasia develops due to unopposed estrogen, which is usually present in ovulatory dysfunction. Now coming to the next non-structural abnormality, endometrial causes. Endometrial causes should be suspected in women with regular ovulatory cycles and when no structural uterine abnormalities are detected. In this case, the primary disorder is at the endometrial level. Endometrial causes can lead to cyclical heavy menstrual bleeding. The mechanism of abnormal uterine bleeding in endometrial causes is an alteration in the PGE is to PGF2-alpha ratio. This leads to increased PGE receptors in the endometrium. This also causes decreased thromboxane production, which is a vasoconstrictor, and increased fibrinolytic activity leading to defective coagulation. The next non-structural abnormality is iatrogenic causes. Iatrogenic means hospital induced. Women can develop abnormal uterine bleeding due to copper intrauterine contraceptive devices, which can cause heavy menstrual bleeding, levonorgestrel intrauterine system, which can cause intermenstrual bleeding and irregular bleeding. Menopausal hormone replacement therapy can cause irregular bleeding. In the same way, estrogen progesterone therapy, which is given for many disorders, can also cause irregular bleeding. Some of the other conditions that can cause abnormal uterine bleeding and are not yet classified are AV malformations in uterus, hypothyroidism, and chronic renal disease. Now let us see how to approach a patient with abnormal uterine bleeding. A thorough history should be taken when a patient presents with abnormal uterine bleeding. The history should include age of the patient, age at menarche, parity, menstrual history. A detailed menstrual history should be taken. The women should be advised to maintain a menstrual diary. The menstrual history should include regularity, frequency, duration, and volume of menstruation. Other history like postcoital bleeding, history of dysmenorrhea, history of dyspareunia or painful intercourse, infertility history, history of vaginal discharge, history of any recent abortion, intrauterine contraceptive device use, oral contraceptive pill use or hormone use, history of symptoms of hypothyroidism, history of symptoms of bleeding disorders, and history of any medications should be taken. Coming to the examination of a patient with abnormal uterine bleeding, general examination should be done. Importantly, BMI should be taken. Paler should be assessed to assess the severity of abnormal uterine bleeding. Thyroid examination should be done to rule out goiter. Signs of polycystic ovarian syndrome should be looked for, like hirsutism, acanthosis nigricans, and acne. Speculum examination should be done to look for any growth. Bimanual pelvic examination should be done. And the following things should be noted in that: size and contour of uterus, tenderness, fixity, adnexal mass, or tenderness or induration. Now let us see about the various investigations that need to be done for a woman with abnormal uterine bleeding. Hemoglobin should be estimated to assess the severity of abnormal uterine bleeding. Complete blood count, bleeding time, clotting time, prothrombin time, and partial thromboplastin time should be assessed to rule out coagulopathy or thrombocytopenia. Thyroid function test should be done to rule out hypothyroidism. Cervical cytology should be done in sexually active women to rule out cervical intraepithelial neoplasia. USG should be done to rule out myoma, polyp, and adenomyosis. Sonohistography can be done if you suspect myoma and polyp. It is basically adenomyosis done after saline infusion into the uterine cavity. Endometrial sampling can be done to rule out hyperplasia and cancer of endometrium. Hysteroscopy can be done if you suspect polyp or submucous myoma. Now let us see about the management of a patient with abnormal uterine bleeding. The general measures include treatment of anemia and lifestyle modifications. Anemia can be treated by oral iron therapy when the hemoglobin is less than 11 gram per deciliter. Packed cell transfusion should be done if the hemoglobin is less than 5 gram per deciliter or when the hemoglobin is less than 10 gram per deciliter and the patient is posted for a surgery. Lifestyle modification in the form of weight reduction should be done to prevent obesity related anovulation. Thereby, this can also prevent abnormal uterine bleeding related to anovulation. The definitive management involves identifying the etiology and correcting it. Now let us see about the management of acute bleeding. This is more common in case of adolescents. A thorough history and examination should be taken to rule out structural abnormalities and coagulopathies. Blood transfusion should be done if the hemoglobin is less than 5 gram per deciliter. The medical treatment of choice is estrogen progestin combination pills. This should be given 8 hourly for the first 48 to 72 hours, followed by 12 hourly for 5 days, followed by once daily for 2 weeks. This comes to a total of 21 days. Then this estrogen progestin combination pill should be continued cyclically for 3 to 6 cycles. If the medical therapy fails to control the bleeding, surgical management is essential. Surgical management is particularly useful when the abnormal uterine bleeding is due to endometrial causes or ovulatory causes. The two surgeries that can be performed are endometrial ablation and hysterectomy. Endometrial ablation is done in case of failed medical therapy. Hysterectomy is a radical procedure and it should be done only when endometrial ablation fails. This picture shows radiofrequency ablation of endometrium. If you have any suggestions, please let me know in the comment section. If you like this video, please like, share, subscribe, and tell your friends about this channel. For more such videos, please check out my playlists. Thank you.